In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Having come to the close of another year, we are compelled to look back upon it and to carry forward its joys and blessings into the new year. Having come to the close of another year, we're compelled to look back upon it and to unburden ourselves before God of all that destroys our happiness and hinders our mission. Merciful Father, this has been another year of sin. We have grieved your heart with our rebellious thoughts, words, and actions. And even though we bear the name Christian, we have failed to lead lives worthy of that calling. We have not done the good things required of us in your commandments. We ask your forgiveness in the name of Jesus, your only Son, who died for our sins. And we ask your Holy Spirit's help in the year now beginning to faithfully reflect the image of Christ. God has heard your confession. His love, mercy, and grace, they're everlasting. Therefore, listen with your heart to the words of St. Paul recorded in the letter to the Romans. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Therefore, as a called servant to the word, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we begin a new year forgiven by God, we are reminded that we are his redeemed saints. We forge ahead in this new year, not in bondage, but in freedom, no longer in futility, but persevering in hope that does not disappoint us. God bless us and keep us in the coming year. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have filled us with the new light of the Word, who became flesh and lived among us. Let the light of our faith shine in all that we do, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. The first lesson for today is recorded in the book of Isaiah, chapter 63, verses 7 through 9. In these words, we understand that just as God lifted up his people of the Old Testament and delivered them, so also God will lift up his people of today and deliver us through this new year and into eternity. I will tell of the kindnesses of the Lord, the deeds for which he is to be praised, according to all the Lord has done for us. Yes, the many good things he has done for Israel, according to his compassion and many kindnesses. He said, surely they are my people, children who will be true to me. And so he became their savior. In all their distress, he too was distressed, and the angel of his presence saves them. In his love and mercy, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. The word of the Lord. The second lesson is recorded in Paul's epistle to the Philippians, chapter 2, verses 9 through 13. Along with all creation, we bow our knee to Jesus by dedicating our lives as thank offerings to him. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act according to in order to fulfill his good purpose. The word of the Lord. Please rise for the gospel. The holy gospel and also our sermon text is this one verse from Luke chapter 23, verse 21. Jesus receives his name and he is circumcised for us. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise the child, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he was conceived. This is the gospel of our Lord. Join me now in confessing your Christian faith. We'll use the words of the Nicene Creed. It's found on page 6 of your worship folder. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated, and we'll join in the hymn of the day, hymn number 376. in the name of Jesus, the name placed on him at his circumcision, given to his parents by the angel. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, when a young Christian couple finds out that they're expecting a child, the first question, I suppose, that comes to their mind is, when is the due date? But after that, there are probably a couple of other questions that need to be answered. First of all, what are we going to name this baby? And secondly, when should we be thinking about a baptism? Maybe the name they choose has some special significance, maybe a family name. For example, my daughter's name, Madeline, middle name Ruth. Madeline was one grandma, Ruth was another. And then there's my son, Everett. There are no Schraders named Everett and no Quants either. Everett is just a name that both his mom and I like the sound of. Sometimes that's the way it works with parents. As far as baptismal dates go, when a couple is in the hospital, I usually encourage them to schedule the baptismal date for that Sunday in the first full week after the baby's born. And then there's sometimes that they say, no, we want to wait till grandma can get here and the rest of the relatives can be at the service. And so that baptismal date gets pushed further and further out. And then every once in a while, there's those parents that want the baby baptized right there in the hospital. Do you ever stop to think about the fact that both those questions were answered for Jesus long before he was born? The angel had said, his name is going to be Jesus. Back then, a name was something that said something about the individual. For example, the name Jacob means heel grabber. And literally, he was grabbing his twin brother's heel as he came out of the womb. And sometimes people's names were changed later on in life to describe them. For example, Jesus gave Simon the name Peter. Peter means rock, because Peter made that rock-solid confession in Jesus as the Son of God and Savior of the world. And then remember, Abram had his name changed. Abram means exalted father. But when God said, I'm going to make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, he changed his name to Abraham, which means father of a multitude. His wife Sarai, she got a name change too. Sarai means quarrelsome, and that was kind of already an appropriate name for her because she quarreled with God about whether or not he was actually going to bless her with a son, but he changed her name to Sarah before her son Isaac was born. Sarah means princess. She was going to give birth to royalty, because from Isaac, ultimately, the King of Kings would one day be born. Mary and Joseph's son, he had a special name too, and it was descriptive. They didn't choose it out of a book of Jewish baby names, but it had been given to them by God himself through the angel. His name will be Jesus. Or Joshua in the Old Testament comes from the Hebrew word yasah, which means to deliver, to set free, or to bestow salvation. Specifically, the name of Jesus, the Lord saves. Baptism, well, that wasn't instituted yet because Jesus was be the one to institute it, but circumcision was about as close to a parallel as there was in the Old Testament. And the date of that rite had been set in stone by ceremonial law. It was to take place 8 days after the birth of a firstborn boy. That's exactly what happened. 8 days after Jesus was born, his parents brought him to the temple for the rite of circumcision. It was a rite that really called to mind their time, the people of Israel's time spent in slavery in Egypt. Remember, God had given the Pharaoh 10 plagues, and the first 9 of them he weathered quite well, but it was that last one that was a doozy. God said, I'm going to send the angel of death throughout the land of Egypt, and he is going to take the life of every firstborn child, every firstborn animal even. And that's exactly what God did. The angel of death struck every single Egyptian home. There was death everywhere, but God gave a promise. See, Pharaoh couldn't ask the people of Israel to leave soon enough. But it was even more than that. God said, if you take a lamb without defect, a perfect lamb, slaughter it and eat it, but then take the blood of that lamb and paint it over the doorposts of your houses, then the angel of death will pass over your house, and he will not bring upon you the death he will bring upon the Egyptians. And God delivered them, just as he promised. And God never wanted them to forget about that deliverance. So he put it right into the ceremonial law. Exodus, he gives this to Moses. The first offspring of every womb belongs to me, including the firstborn of males of your livestock, whether from herd or flock. They were to be consecrated to God. That's what circumcision was. It was the consecrating of the firstborn to God. And so Mary and Joseph brought their firstborn to the temple to be consecrated through circumcision, just as the law required. I want to talk about that for a little bit, because there's some significance there, and I don't want you to think that it was just Mary and Joseph doing what the law required of them, and this was just another firstborn son. This is nothing more and nothing less than Jesus shedding his blood for you for the very first time. On New Year's Day, we tend to look back at the past year, take a little bit of a personal inventory of our lives. So let me ask you, was 2016, was it a good year for you? I don't mean, did you get a promotion at work? Or did you improve your golf score? I'm not talking about that. I don't mean, did you do well financially, or did you buy and move into a new house? So I'm talking about a spiritual inventory. So let me ask you again, how did you do in 2016? Did you make God your top priority, or was he just another one of your priorities? Did you make his word the central focus of your home, or was his word more of a hobby that you did once a week for about an hour on Sundays, at least most of them? Did you dedicate your lives in service to your King? Did you serve others out of love, or did you spend most of your time, just like you did in the year before, serving yourself? If we're honest with ourselves, we have to admit we haven't just cracked God's laws, we've shattered them to pieces. And then there's something a little bit off when we come here on New Year's Day and say, God, bless me going forward into the new year. Considering everything I've done, go ahead and shower your goodness upon me anyway. Think about this. If you were behind the wheel of a car, and because of your texting and driving, you plowed right through that intersection and mowed over a little kid in the crosswalk, there'd be some questions, wouldn't there, if you failed like that? Two of them come to mind for me. First of all, who's going to pay for this? And secondly, who's going to make it right? And the truth is, when we've shattered and slaughtered God's law, we have to come to the grips with the fact that he's going to ask those very same questions of us. Who's going to pay for this? And who's going to make it right? That's why it's good news when we look at this gospel lesson in Luke, because Luke answers both those questions for us. Who's going to pay for this? It's Jesus. And who's going to make it right? It's Jesus. When we think about Jesus shedding his blood for us, don't we most often go to the cross, that hill outside of Jerusalem, and we think about the nails that pierced his hands and the spear that pierced his side? But really, the first time Jesus shed his blood for you was long before that. 8 days old, in the temple, in the rite of circumcision, Jesus shed his blood for you. And if he was going to live up to his name, Jesus, the Lord saves, then shedding his blood is exactly what he had to do. God told his people that in no uncertain terms, all the way back in the Old Testament. It was part of their worship, right? They brought their sacrifices to the altar, and they shed the blood of lambs and goats and bulls and doves. That blood of those animals was shed for forgiveness, and yet they really didn't forgive sin, did they? Animal blood can never forgive sins. The only blood that can truly purify us is the blood of the sinless Lamb of God. And it was vital that his blood be shed. As Jesus was circumcised, he was making that first payment of blood for the sins of our past year and the sins of the year going forward. He was taking our place. He was paying our penalties so that God could give us his forgiveness. Now, I can't imagine if someone don't mow down my kid in the crosswalk, I can't imagine them saying, oh, as long as he spends a little time in jail, that's good enough payment. You know, I can't even imagine if that person died and they shed their blood for their crime. I can't even imagine saying that's sufficient payment. But when Jesus sheds his blood, it's payment in full. Because it's God's blood, sinless blood, holy blood, and righteous blood. Your debt is done, your guilt is paid, your sins are removed. You are pure in the eyes of your God. But you know what? On Judgment Day, when Jesus returns again, he's going to ask for more than that we be washed in his blood. He's going to demand exactly what he demanded from the beginning of Adam and Eve. He's going to demand perfect obedience as well, a record of righteousness. He's going to look at our lives and he's going to examine them for examples of obedience. He's going to look at our deeds and see whether they were done out of pure love. He's going to look at our service and see if it was selfless. Last Sunday, as our confession of sins, we used the last part of the Athanasian Creed. I'm wondering if when you confessed that, it made you a little uncomfortable. Let me read the words again. At his coming, all people will rise with their own bodies to answer for their personal deeds. Those who have done good will enter eternal life, but those who have done evil will enter eternal fire. I don't know about you, but when I look at my deeds, I don't see a whole lot of good. And when I look at my deeds and compare them to God's law, the way he wants me to live, I see a whole lot of evil. And I come to the realization that I'm the one that deserves that fire. But that's why Jesus came. And that's why Jesus was circumcised. He was circumcised to shed his blood for us, but it was the beginning of a perfect life. Only 8 days old, a little baby, Jesus was doing what the law required, not for himself. He was already sinless. He was God himself. No, Jesus was doing that for you and for me. You see it again at age 12. Where do his parents find him? In the temple, about his father's business. You see it with Jesus out in the wilderness, being tempted by the devil, defeating every single one of Satan's temptations, using the powerful word of God. Jesus living a perfect life, a sinless life, a holy life for you and for me. And he did it perfectly. So much so that the writer to the Hebrews says that Jesus was every bit just like us, and yet he was without sin. At the end of his ministry, he was surrounded by his enemies, and he looked them all in the eye and he said, "Any one of you, just prove me guilty of just one sin." These were people who wanted him dead. They couldn't do it. There was absolute silence. And then Jesus took that holy life, that perfect life as our substitute, and he gave it to God for us on the cross. Yes, with Jesus' blood, he washes away our sin, but with his perfect life, he fulfills the law for us. And Christ, Jesus' work is summarized for us in the words of the Apostle Paul as he writes to the Corinthians. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That's what you are. The righteousness of God in Jesus Christ, that holy life he led in perfection from the time he was a little baby to the time he drew his last breath on the cross. When God looks at you on that last day and he starts reading off the list of good things you've done, he's not going to look at your good things. He's not going to see your bad things. Instead, he's only going to see Jesus. And the perfect life he lives is given to you by faith and deposited into your account, and that's your ticket. And mine too. Your ticket to be given to God at the gates of heaven. And so on this New Year's Day, we can sing that last hymn with joyful hearts. Listen to the words again. Jesus, your blood and righteousness, my beauty are my glorious dress. Mid flaming worlds in these arrayed, with joy shall I lift up my head. Bold shall I stand on that great day. Who can a word against me say? Fully through you absolved I am from sin and fear, from guilt and shame. New Year's Day is about predictions, right? Sometimes. I'm going to give you a couple of predictions. First of all, your life in this world, it's not going to be exactly the same as it was in 2016. Circumstances are going to be different. That we know for sure. But the other thing we know for sure is that no matter what the circumstances are, God is going to be there with you every step of the way. And his goodness and his love and his mercy and forgiveness, they're going to relentlessly pursue you every day of your life. Every day of 2017 and the next year and into eternity. You could bank on that. How about some resolutions? In 2017, God help us proudly and confidently bear the name of Christ. May we live that each day in the image that he's given us. Through faith, God help us defeat every single one of Satan's temptations. Let us use the power that you've given us, the very same power that Jesus used in the wilderness, the power of word and sacrament, because that's the power that defeats those temptations. And God, help us to offer our lives every single day as a thank offering, living sacrifices to him who shed his blood for us and who lived his life for us. Amen. The peace of God that transcends all human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. You may now be seated. We'll bring our offering to the Lord. Please use this as an opportunity to sign the friendship register and pass it down to the others in your row. Please rise for prayer. It is fitting, O Lord, in these first hours of this new year, to express our gratitude for the countless gifts of grace we've received from you. You clothe your creation with beauty. You feed even the birds and tell us that we are much more valuable than they. Clothing and food, safety and health, possessions and money, even life itself, all these come to us from your generous hand. We thank you especially for your word and Holy Supper, which strengthen our faith, shield us from temptation, and equip us for service. Almighty and eternal God, you have been gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. As you led your people Israel with a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, so lead us by the light of your word, that we may live our lives to your glory and be prepared to die in your peace. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love, he has given us every blessing in Christ. In the days of Isaiah, he promised a sign to his people that a child would be born of a virgin. In fulfillment of that promise, his son Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary and has come among us to bring redemption and forgiveness of sins. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, and with believers of all times and places, we praise your glorious name. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
May this strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen.
Thank you.
May this strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. May this strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. May this strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen.
Please join me now in the closing prayer. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this past year from all harm and danger. Keep us this year also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. Into your hands I commend my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angels be with me, that the wicked foe may have no power over me. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. You may be seated. We'll close our worship with the first verse of hymn 75.